stand for the reading of the word of this morning. Amen. This morning will come from 2 Chronicles chapter 20. 2 Chronicles chapter 20. And we're going to look at verses 14 through 17. 2 Chronicles chapter 20. Verses 14 through 17. Amen. And it reads as follows in verse 14. It says, "Then upon Jahaziel, the son of Zechariah, the son of Benaniah, the son of Jeiel, the son of Mattaniah, a Levite of the sons of Asaph, came the Spirit of the Lord in the midst of the congregation. And he said, Hearken ye all Judah, and ye inhabitants of Jerusalem, and thou King Jehoshaphat, thus saith the Lord unto you, Be not afraid, nor dismayed by reason of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Tomorrow go ye down against them. Behold, they come up by the cliff of Ziz, and ye shall find them at the end of the brook, before the wilderness of Jeruel. Ye shall not need to fight in this battle. Set yourselves, stand ye still, and see the salvation of the Lord with you. O Judah and Jerusalem, fear not, nor be dismayed. Tomorrow go out against them, for the Lord will be with you." Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, for another opportunity to stand for your people and proclaim your word. Lord, please decrease all of me and increase all of you. Holy Spirit, have your way. It's in Jesus' name that we do pray. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We are in our Fearless series this month, and this is part 3 in our Fearless series. The subtitle for today is Stand Still. Stand still. Jehoshaphat was the king of Judah. He was a king that loved God and wasn't afraid to show it, and he wasn't afraid to tell it. As a matter of fact, King Jehoshaphat loved God so much that he had some of his government officials teach the word of God throughout the different cities of Judah. Wouldn't that be lovely if our government officials would allow the word of God to go forth without them trying to suppress it?
Yes.
But King Jehoshaphat, he loved God. Also in 2 Chronicles 19, verses 5 through 7, Jehoshaphat appointed judges. He appointed judges. And when he appointed them, he told them that when they oversee different cases, that the ruling that they made on a case, they were to make sure that they heard from God. They were to make sure that they heard from God, and whatever God told them to do, that's what they were supposed to do. He told them to be fair, be honest, and obey God. And at the same time, he said, don't take any bribes either. Be fair and honest, and don't take any bribes. You see, you probably thought bribes had just taken place and it started in the 20th and 21st century. But government officials have been taking bribes for a long time. So here you have Jehoshaphat saying, don't take any bribes, but be honest and be fair. And when you make your ruling on a case, make sure hear from God. So as we can see already, King Jehoshaphat, he was a man of integrity. He was a man that loved God. But just because you love God, it does not mean that your life is absent from trouble. Just because you love God, it does not mean that you are immune to trouble. As a matter of fact, I could build a solid case from scripture that to show you individuals who love God, but yet trouble and issues consistently found them. them out, and it came into the lives of God's people. But we're just going to look at one individual this morning, and that is King Jehoshaphat. 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 1, it tells us that the Moabites and the Ammonites and some of the Midianites came up against Jehoshaphat to do battle. When word gets back to Jehoshaphat about them coming and attacking them, it took Jehoshaphat by surprise. It took him by surprise. He wasn't ready to be attacked. He was not ready to go to battle. By Jehoshaphat not being fully prepared, verse number 3 tells us that he was in fear. He loved God. He served God, but he was in fear. Have issues or things ever taken you by surprise that you weren't fully prepared for and you had to face it? What did you do? How did you react? What was going on in your mind? Who was the first person you called when you found out that things were going on? What was the first thing you did? But the most important question is, could the person that you call even help you in your situation? I'm going to take my time this morning. The Bible says, watch this, that Jehoshaphat was in fear. He was in fear of these armies attacking them. But as I told you before, Jehoshaphat loved God. He served God. He worshiped God. So when trouble came his way, watch this, he knew exactly who to call on to help him out. In today's time, Jay, these cell phones and so forth, I don't know many people phone numbers. I don't know a lot of folks' phone numbers. These cell phones, Rodney, you look up a name in a cell phone, you see the name, and you just press a button, boop, and calls that person. I know a few numbers. I know my wife's number by heart. I know my daughter's number by heart. But certain numbers in there and certain people, I don't know their phone numbers by heart because of technology and so forth. Now, back in the day, we didn't have cell phones. You knew folks' numbers. They had to go to the phone book that much, but you knew their number. You could call out by number. You probably know people's numbers from back in the day that who used to call all the time. But people that you have just met, you don't know their phone number. You know you don't know their phone number. You look up their name in your phone and you hit their name and call that person. You don't know their phone number. You know, it's even a section in the phone that has favorites. You put your favorite people in your favorites. It's like speed dial. You know, the people you call the most, you put them in your favorites. For some of us, we might have some restaurants. Got one or two restaurants in my favorites.
Yeah.
Maybe three or four restaurants. Okay, maybe four or five restaurants. Just a few restaurants I have in my favorites. And I call them whenever I need them because I call them a lot and they're in my favorites. If I were to look at your cell phone spiritually, I wonder who is in your favorites. I wonder if God is in your spiritual cell phone. Is he in your favorites? Do you call upon him just whenever you need to call upon him? Do you call upon him every day? Do you wake up in the morning calling upon him? Do you call upon him at the noonday hour? Do you call upon him in the midnight hour? Is he in your favorites? You see, Jehoshaphat was used to calling on God. If Jehoshaphat lived in the 21st century, I'm pretty sure that God would be in his spiritual favorites. He knew who to call upon when he was in trouble. Fear gripped Jehoshaphat, but he knew who to call upon when he was in trouble. Verse number 3, it says, watch this, it says, and Jehoshaphat feared and set himself to seek the Lord and proclaim a fast throughout all Judah. So he has fear, and there's no doubt about that. But although he has fear, fear does not have him. And let me say that again. He has fear, but fear does not have him. Grace Center, there may be times when you will have fear, but I'm encouraging you not to let fear have you. Don't let fear grip you to the point where you can't move. Don't let fear grip you to the point where you're more concerned about what others may say instead of what God is saying. Jehoshaphat said, I'm not going to let fear grip me, but I'm going to do something about it. What did he do? He called a fast. He called a fast. Fasting is a spiritual discipline. It is a spiritual discipline that believers can use, and they have it in their arsenal. Fasting is powerful. Grace, and don't forget to fast over some situations. Don't forget about the weapon and the powerful weapon of fasting. Jehoshaphat said, I've got something in my arsenal that can handle this thing called fear, and it's called fasting. But it wasn't only Jehoshaphat that was fasting. All of the cities in Judah was fasting as well. Verse number 4 says, they all came together to ask help from the Lord. In other words, they put aside their personal differences. They put aside their personal likes and dislikes. They say, we're going to come together and we're going to seek the Lord. It's time for the body of Christ to come together and seek the Lord. It's time that we as a nation come together and seek the Lord. It's time that we come and seek the Lord for our government officials. It's time we come together and seek the Lord for our families. It's time we all come together and seek the Lord. So Deacon Drew, they all came together to seek the Lord. And then the Bible says that Jehoshaphat, watch this, he stood in the midst of the congregation. And then he decided to do something as he stood there. The Bible says that he prayed unto God. He went and he stood in the midst of the congregation, and then he prayed to God. You see, when you're not ashamed of him, it doesn't matter who you are around and who's around you. Jehoshaphat prayed to God in the midst of the people. And in his prayer, he asked God a question in the midst of his prayer. He asked him, he said, in thine hand is there not power and might, so that no one is able to withstand thee? In other words, he asked God a question he already knew the answer to. He knew that God was full of power, Ms. Charlotte. He knew that God was full of might, right? He knew there wasn't anything too hard for the Lord. But also in his prayer, he began to remind God of what he did for his people in the past. He reminded God of how he took care of them and how he took care of Abraham by driving out Abraham's enemies. You see, sometimes you have to remind God of what he either did for you or what he did for somebody else. It's not that God is forgetful. It's not that God has amnesia. It's just that you're letting God that you haven't forget about the great things that he has already done. Sometimes you just have to remind him of how great he is. Sometimes you have to remind him of how wonderful he is. He doesn't have spiritual amnesia. It's just for you to remind him how great and mighty he is. And after he reminds God of what he has done for them in the past, he then asks God to do something for them in the present. He reminded God of what he's done for them in the past, but then he reminds God of what he can do for them in the present. He says, right now, Lord, that the children of Ammon and Moab and Mount Seir are coming after us. They're coming to attack us. Then Jehoshaphat was like, you know, we did not attack them beforehand, but now they're coming to attack us. In other words, Jehoshaphat, you read Deuteronomy chapter 2, it talked about how God told his people not to invade their enemies. He told them to turn in the other direction. In other words, don't mess with them, just leave and go in the other direction. So now Jehoshaphat is saying, Lord, there was a time when we could have attacked them, but now they're coming after us. We didn't attack them, but now they're repaying us by attacking us. You told us to not attack them in the past, but look at them and look how they are now repaying us. They're not grateful for us not attacking them, because now they're coming after us. And besides, Lord, you're the one that even gave us this land. You're the one that gave it to us, and we are trusting in you. Jehoshaphat, he revealed to God their weakness. Verse 12, it says that he told God how he felt and how he felt that they were inferior to their enemies. He said, we're not strong enough or powerful enough to do battle against them. But the good thing is that Jehoshaphat didn't stop there. After he told God how he felt about their inability to go against their enemies, he said something else that was key in verse number 12. He said something else that was key in verse number 12. He said, watch this. He said, although we may not be as strong, although we may not be as powerful, we know someone who is. We may not be as strong as they are. We may not be as powerful as they are, but we know someone who is. And since we know someone that is all powerful and that is almighty, what are we going to do? We are going to, watch this, we're going to look upon thee. The King James verse says, our eyes are upon thee. Jehoshaphat knew where to look for his help. He knew where to look for his help. The gospel singer for John Mitchell, he has a song out entitled Nobody Greater. He has a song entitled Nobody Greater. And in the chorus line of that song, it says that he searched all over, couldn't find nobody. He looked high and he looked low, but he still couldn't find nobody. And he finally came to the conclusion, Deacon Drew, that there's nobody greater. I looked high, I looked low, I searched all over, but I couldn't find nobody. And he came to the conclusion there is nobody greater than God. Grace said that there has to come a time in our lives where we come to the conclusion that there is no one greater than God. And since there is nobody greater, when we find ourselves with our backs up against the wall, all we have to do is look up, for which coming forth our help. We have to look toward the healer. Where our help coming from? Jehoshaphat said, you know what? Our eyes are upon thee. After Jehoshaphat prayed and closed out his prayer by saying, our eyes are upon thee, verse 13 says that the people stood before the Lord. Let me say that again. He prayed to God. He closed out his prayer by saying, our eyes are upon thee. But then he says that the people stood before the Lord. In other words, after they prayed, they stood there until they received the answer. They prayed to God, then they stood there. And they waited until they received the answer from the Lord. When in your prayer time, don't be so quick to pray and just get up. Sometimes you may just have to stay there just a little while longer. You don't just be so quick to close out the prayer in Jesus' name. Just get up just like that. Just stay there. Just soak in his presence just a little while longer. He prayed, but then he stood there. of the Lord came upon one of the men in the congregation. This man was a Levite by the name of Jahaziel. It says that the Spirit of the Lord came upon Jahaziel, and the word says that Jahaziel began to prophesy. Oh, the church never get back to prophesy. Oh, he got back and he heard from the Lord, and Jahaziel began to prophesy. He said, you see, I told you all last week in the church service that it's not always good to go to bedside Baptist. Every once in a while, you need to come into the house of the Lord. I just said this last week. And here it is in demonstration of God speaking to someone in the midst of the congregation, and he begins to prophesy to the people. He begins to prophesy. God used the Levite Jahaziel to prophesy. And he told them, watch this, he told them, do not be afraid. In other words, don't fear. Don't worry about how many are on their side. Don't worry about how large their army is. Don't fear. And then he says, the battle is not yours, but the battle is the Lord's. The battle is not your battle, but the battle is the Lord's. Now, the text is very clear. It tells us there's going to be a battle. There's going to be some combat in the battle. So a battle is going to take place. Now, what is a battle? A battle is combat between two or more combatants. A battle is a hostile encounter or engagement between opposing military forces. But not only that, you see, sometimes you can have more than one battle within a war. Teach, Pastor. You sometimes can have more than one battle within a war. You see, for some of you, the battle that you may be in right now is not your first battle. And I hate to tell you, it's not going to be your last battle. Some of you may ask, well, right now, I'm not in a battle. And that's okay, but just like the old school saints would say, just keep on living. Keep on living. You're going to get into some battles. Because in this life, you will have some battles, and one battle may not look like another battle. This battle may not look like that battle, but in this Life Grace Center, you are going to have some battles. And those battles that may be taking place, they may be taking place in the midst of a war. Newsflash, there is a war going on. There is a war going on. There is a war going on in the supernatural. A war is taking place in the supernatural, and the war is not going to end until the millennial reign of Christ is over with. That's when the war is going to end. That's a whole other teaching. We'll get to that at some point later on. But the war that we're in, we are going to face many battles. You are going to be in many battles. But although you may be in some battles, the battles that you may even be in, it may not be your battle. It may not even be your battle. You see, the battle that you may be facing is probably not even yours. But the battle that you're facing is probably the Lord's. Watch this. Jahaziel, he said, there's going to be a battle. A battle is going to take place. But check it out. It's not your battle. Amen. The battle that you're going to be in is the Lord's battle. Grace Center, if you're in a battle, I've got good news for you. The battle is not yours, but the battle is the Lord's. Yes. But not only is that good news, absolute great news. Can I tell you why it's great news? It's great news because we serve a God who's the ultimate military strategist. He owns all the pieces on the chessboard. He knows what's going to happen before you know what's going to happen.
Right.
He knows what's going to happen before your enemy knows what's going to happen. Let me say it another way. He knows what your enemy is going to do before your enemy knows what they're going to do. He's the ultimate military strategist. It's like you're watching a movie and you're seeing the movie a thousand times. But then you're watching a movie with somebody else who is seeing the movie for the first time. I'm pretty sure you all can quote word by word The Color Purple. I know you can. You've seen the movie a thousand times. You know scene by scene what's going to happen in the movie. Now somebody else come and sit beside you, it may be their first time seeing the movie. But since you already seen the movie, you know what's going to take place next in the script.
That's right.
The other person beside you has no idea what's going to take place. But you've already seen the movie. You know what's going to happen at the end of the movie. You see, God already knows what's going to happen at the end of your movie. He already has seen it. He already knows what's going to happen next. Your enemy may not know. You may not know. But God already knows what's going to take place next. Great Center, the battle that you're in is not your battle, but the battle is the Lord's. After Jehaziel tells them that the battle is not theirs, but God's, he then tells them to go out by the cliff of Ziz, and you'll see your enemy by the brook. He then reiterates to them, he said, you know what? Don't go fight in this battle. Just go out there. You're going to see your enemy by the brook. But you don't have to fight in this battle. The only thing you have to do when you get there is stand still. You don't have to do anything. Just show up is the only thing that you have to do. Your hands is not going to get dirty in this fight. You are not going to sweat in this fight. The only thing you need to do is show up and stand still. And while you are standing there, you know, what you're doing is that you're believing in God. You're believing that God is going to show up. There's no need for you to do anything but stand there, because there's no need for you to move when God is already moving on your behalf. It was so nice that God said that twice. All you have to do is stand there. It's no need for you to move, because God is going to move on your behalf. And that may be a word for somebody in here today. All you have to do is show up and just stand still. And Grace said, you know, it takes faith to stand still. It takes faith to show up and stand still. Because you think that you have to place your hands in it. You think you have to get involved in it. You think that you can help out the situation. But the only thing God told you to do was show up and stand still. And let me tell you this right now. You can write this down. You can tweet this. You can Facebook this. But let me tell you this right here. If God's hands are in it, take your hands out of it. Say that again. If God's hands are in it, take your hands out of it. The battle that you may be in is not even your battle. Take your hands out of the battle. Trust and believe what God has already told you, what he's going to do. The only thing you need to do is stand still. Stand still when you receive a bad report from the doctor. Stand still when you receive a pink slip. Stand still when the job turns you down. Stand still when the bank says no. Stand still when your body is aching with pain. Stand
out on you. Grace Center, there's come a time when you need to come to the conclusion that you just simply need to stand still. Oh wait, there is more to the prophecy. There's more to the prophecy. Jehaziel said, while you're standing there, you also need to see the salvation of the Lord. you're standing, but while you're standing there, you also need to see something. You need to see God save or rescue you. You prayed, you fasted, and I gave you a word to stand still, but while you're standing there, watch God go to work. Watch God intervene in that situation. After the prophetic word went forth, in verse number 18, it says that Jehoshaphat, along with all of Judah and Jerusalem, they bowed down and they worshiped the Lord. In other words, they're worshiping God for the prophetic word that was given to them. And after all of this, Jehoshaphat had a brilliant idea to place singers in front of the army. They prayed, they fasted, they received a prophetic word from God telling them to stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. And then Jehoshaphat, he said, you know what, we're going to place singers in front of the army. Because there's no need for an army when you have singers, when God told you that the battle is not even your battle. If he would have placed the army in front, it would have been like he was doubting what God said he would do. But he's saying, since God has already told us that the battle is not ours but his, what we're going to do, we're going to praise God in advance. We're going to say hallelujah in advance. We're going to praise his name in advance. We're not going to have the army go out forth. It's no need for our army to do anything but show up and stand there and see the salvation of the Lord. He put the singer in the front. It seemed like it would be a dumb idea. It seemed like it would be a crazy idea to place singers in front of the army, but Jehoshaphat believed what God had already told them by telling them that the battle was not even their battle. So they go out there praising the name of the Lord. He had the faith to say, army, step back. He had the faith to say, singers, step forward. Army, get back. Singers, get forth. Praise leaders, come up forth. Army, get back. The army wanted to fight. An army is conditioned to fight. An army is ready to fight. But he said, army, you're not going to need to fight. All we have to do is show up. He says, singers, step forward, and army, I need for you all to step back. When you read the text, it says that when they began to sing praises unto God, the Lord set up an ambushment among the enemies. In other words, he caused the enemies to fight amongst themselves. He caused the table to turn on the enemy. In other words, Jehoshaphat and his people, they began to sing and to praise God. And as they're singing and praising God, the enemy are down there fighting one another. The battle is not yours, but the battle is the Lord's. Sometimes after we pray and we fast, we need to praise and thank God. We need to raise up a hand or two and thank God. We need to say hallelujah and thank you, Jesus, and praise your most holy name. Every once in a while, I didn't play my iPad every day. Every once in a while, one hand needs to go up over here, another hand needs to go up over here, and you need to sometimes thank him for what he's about to do. You may not even believe what he's going to do, but when the Lord told you he's going to do something, he's going to do exactly what he said he's going to do. You may can't figure it out. Your mama can't figure it out. Your daddy can't figure it out. Your coworker can't figure it out. Your neighbor can't figure it out. You're wondering, how is all of this going to take place? They were used to fighting. to war, but this time he said, you know what, I have the faith by the prophetic word of Jahaziel telling us that the battle is not ours, but the Lord's.
Amen.
You just simply have to stand there.
Amen.
They're standing there, and God calls the enemies to turn on one another. As you continue to read the text, it talks about how they took all of the leftovers that the enemy has left over. The enemy was scattered. They were dead. They were gone. God calls them to turn on themselves. They went out there. They stood still. And they saw the salvation of the Lord. They saw God rescue them. They saw God save them. Grayson, that's your word for today. The battle is not your battle. Whatever you're facing, whatever you're going through, the battle is not your battle. But the battle is the Lord's. The only thing you have to do is stand still. Whatever it may be that you're facing, just stand still. Don't try to figure out how God is going to work it out. Just stand still.
Yes.
Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. But while you're standing there, go ahead and just clean your glasses off. Put this new contact if you have to. And see the salvation of the Lord. Yeah. Just stand there and look at what God is going to do. Just stand there. Later time, just stand still. Rock, just stand still, brother.
Yeah.
Jay, just stand still.
Yeah.
Barry family, just stand still. Denarius, stand still. Family, stand still. Bishop, stand still. Deacon Drew, show up to the battle. But when you get there, just stand still. You don't have to fight in this one. You're not going to have to sweat in this next fight. The battle is not your battle to fight. Whatever battle you're going through, the battle is the Lord's. You know, Friday night, I told y'all earlier, we went out bowling and so forth. And usually I'm done with my sermons before Friday. I like to have my Friday nights and my weekends free. But after we got home from bowling, I was up to 3 o'clock Friday night working on this sermon still. I was just working on it. I didn't go to bed until 3:30 Friday night or Saturday morning. The word that I'm giving you for today, I don't play around with the word of God. I put a lot of time, a lot of prayer. Sometimes I even fast over these different sermons and so forth. I'm telling you right now, the battle that you're in is not your battle. The battle is the Lord's. Don't lose any more sleep of what you're going through. Don't lose any sleep of what is happening in your life. It's not your battle. Things that are happening to you, it may have taken you by surprise, just like it took Jehoshaphat by surprise, but it did not take God by surprise. He knew exactly what was going to happen, what was going to go down, and he knew exactly what he would do to their enemies. Grace Center, stand still. Something come up against you this week, stand still. But while you're standing there, clean your glasses off, wear contacts, put them back in, and just look and see what God is going to do in your life. Amen. Praise God. Doors of the church are open.